Welcome back. Did you ever experience that your mobile phone or PC stopped responding and you needed to push the reset button to get it back alive? Or worse, that it really got broke? I bet you did. What would happen if this occurs in a spacecraft? Well, the answer is simple. Unless you have 100 million euro to send a few astronauts for on-site repair, it may simply be the end of your mission. In previous sessions, I already discussed reliability and some typical failure causes. In this session, we will elaborate on that. We will discover all kinds of ways to destroy a satellite, and also some ways to prevent it. I've put this session in the part on command data handling, but as you will find out, many things discussed here can also occur on spacecraft subsystems. So let's first sum up the major failure causes in software and electronics. Software bugs and electrical design flaws are human errors which speak for themselves. They are, however, a major source of onboard failures. Radiation can damage electrical devices. I will elaborate on this later. Before the launch, components can corrode in humid environments. In orbit, the extreme thermal environment can lead to thermoelectrical and thermomechanical stresses. Both can lead to open or short circuits or change the electrical properties of a device. During the launch, there can be extreme vibrations due to the awesome amount of power generated by the rockets. Finally, there can be component manufacturing errors or assembly errors of components. Here, you can see an example of how a bad solder joint in combination with mechanical stresses can lead to an open circuit fault. While most failure causes are pretty straightforward, like this example, we will pay some more attention to radiation. There is an abundance of particle radiation in space. In this picture, you can see a solar eruption which fires an enormous amount of protons and ions into space. These eruptions occur all the time, but the Sun experiences a cycle of about 11 years with an active maximum and a passive minimum. Still, the activity and the eruptions are very hard to predict, let alone the direction of the particle blast. Here you can see the Van Allen belts. The inner belt has protons trapped and the outer belt has electrons trapped. It is the Earth magnetic field which keeps them trapped. The protons are more energetic and harder to shield against than the electrons. Please take note of an area above the South Atlantic where the inner belt comes very low and also impacts the lowest Earth orbits. This is called the South Atlantic anomaly. In this graph, all the detected radiation events of a satellite called UOSAT-3 are plotted. This clearly shows the impact of the South Atlantic anomaly. While the magnetic field of the Earth is to blame for the Van Allen belts, I should also note that this same magnetic field protects the Earth and low Earth orbits from the majority of particle radiation coming from the Sun. Only near the poles, some of the solar particle radiation still protrudes, leading to the beautiful light phenomenon known as the aurora borealis. Cosmic rays are a third source with mainly protons and ions. They come from all kinds of sources in the universe. Radiation hitting a surface of a spacecraft structure or component can also lead to secondary radiation. A high-energy particle can also create bremsstrahlung, comprising electromagnetic radiation, electrons and ions. It's like the white billiard ball hitting a pool of nice arranged other balls like is shown in this picture. So now we know about the radiation environment. But what does radiation do to the electronics inside a spacecraft? Charging means that there is a buildup of electronics, but an insulator prevents them to flow. This creates a voltage difference, which can lead to biasing of transistors. It can also lead to sparking if the voltage level becomes too high for the insulator to withstand. Sparking can lead to transients in the circuits with potential harmful consequences. A proper grounding of the body and the solar panels can prevent most charging issues. Ionization means that atoms or molecules within the electronics lose or gain an electron due to a hit with a radiation particle. A single ionization typically does not significantly change the properties of an electrical component, but the buildup over time can change the threshold values and lead to leakage currents. Single event effects are events which immediately take place after a radiation particle strikes. An upset is a change of state of logic component. This is, for instance, a bit flip in the memory of software. A latch-up is a short circuit in a component which can be caused if the heat released by a particle changes the properties of the material locally. If the latch-up sustains, it can have a cascading effect on the other parts of the circuit or integrated circuit. A rupture or burnout is a direct destruction of the component or logic unit in an integrated circuit. There's not so much to do about the latter, but luckily the chance is also limited. A measure to quantify ionization is the total ionization dose, which is expressed in radiation absorbed dose, or RAD. Radiation-hardened electronics can operate to much higher doses of ionization. Commercial off-the-shelf integrated circuits typically can sustain between 1 and 10 kilorads before they start to malfunction or completely stop working. Manufacturers, however, don't provide you any data on the exact level. Radiation-hardened electronics can sustain between 100 and 1,000 kilorad. Manufacturers provide you the levels which can be taken into account in a design. Radiation hardening is a combination of local shielding and the different transistor layout. The transistors are larger and consume more power than their commercial equivalents. Since the market is orders of magnitude smaller and the production process is more complex, prices are between 100 and 100,000 times higher. So the question is, do we really need it? First of all, aluminum is a good shielding material for a part of the radiation. This lightweight material can be used for the outer structure of the spacecraft and will shield the electronics inside. The thickness of the panel determines the amount of shielding. You can also apply aluminum boxes around your electronics for even more protection. Take note, however, that shielding very close to the actual electronics can potentially also lead to a larger flux of Bremsstrahlung. Now let's take a look at the study of ESA. On the horizontal axis, we see the thickness of the aluminum shielding. On the vertical axis, we see the total ionization dose on a logarithmic scale. The lower purple plot is an example of a low Earth orbit mission of 8 years. With about 3 millimeters of shielding, the total ionization dose would remain below 10 kilorad. If your mission time is sufficiently small, or you can allow a bit of risk, commercial off-the-shelf electronics can be sufficient in this case. For a geostationary orbit at 36,000 kilometers altitude and a mission lifetime of 18 years, you need at least 10 millimeters of shielding to get down to 10 kilorad. This is not impossible, but since geostationary satellites are very expensive and perform critical tasks for society, commercial off-the-shelf components are typically avoided because of risk aversion. The upper two lines are for JUICE mission at the moons of Jupiter. As you can see, even 10 millimeters of shielding will yield 200 kilorad of total ionization. For this mission, commercial off-the-shelf electronics will simply not suffice. Now let's discuss a latch-up. A radiation particle can create a parasitic structure in an integrated circuit. On some locations, this can lead to a short circuit. Latch-ups are triggered by heavy ions, protons, and neutrons. CMOS is most susceptible to latch-up. CMOS stands for complementary metal oxide semiconductor. It is a very popular semiconductor type as it yields very low power consumption compared to others. This susceptibility can be mitigated by using silicon on insulator substrates. For the integrated circuits, the insulator in the substrate prevents parasitic structures which can cause a latch-up. It is even somewhat faster and more efficient than CMOS on bulk silicon substrates, which is the current mainstream. The manufacturing cost for silicon on insulator increases with about 10%. For space-grade components, this is peanuts. But for bulk commercial electronics, this is still a barrier which prevents major availability. The good news, however, is that this technique allows for further miniaturization and speed improvements, and we can expect more commercial electronics to make the step towards silicon on insulator. But is there also a way to simply deal with a lead shop? Well, if you implement fast and adequate detection and power cycling, a major part of the lead shops can still be resolved in time. After this power cycle, the parasitic structure is gone. This mechanism can be designed around the integrated circuit, but can also be part of the integrated circuit. For commercial off-the-shelf electronics, however, you typically don't know if such mechanisms are embedded. So we know now how a satellite can fail. We also know a few ways to reduce the chances of failures. But what else can we do? The first measure is to apply redundancy. Spare systems or components can replace broken ones. This sounds simpler than it actually is. For instance, does the spare have to be in the same state as the primary, or is it okay to start fresh in a default configuration? Keeping the state of a spare updated is rather complex and requires power. Secondly, spares do not resolve human errors in the design and testing, especially if the spare is identical. Also, the total ionization dose on the spare will be about equal to the primary. For some of these reasons, you can opt for a backup solution which is slightly different to the nominal device, but this will make your design more complex. Nonetheless, if properly implemented, redundancy can lower the overall system failure probability. To properly implement redundancy, you might need onboard autonomy to detect a failure on a subsystem or component, isolate it, and switch over to the backup system. Failure detection, isolation, and recovery, abbreviated as FDIR, can also be used to deal with soft errors such as data bus lookups and anomalous behavior of software. FDIR can also be used for graceful degradation. Think, for instance, of dealing with less solar power due to a failure of part of the solar array. Graceful degradation simply means that you accept less performance and can still continue your mission as critical functionality still remains. It's like your human body once you have passed age of 25. A lot of trouble can be prevented by proper component selection. We already talked about radiation-hardened electronics. There are also fault-tolerant components, for instance, integrated circuits, which compute the same step twice or more and compare the outcome. Or, for instance, internal lead shop protection and FDIR in an integrated circuit. However, if you want to use commercial off-the-shelf electronics, it might be hard, if not impossible, to find specifications of radiation tolerance and internal failure measures. You can, however, perform screening of those components by testing them in a radiation particle accelerator facility and thermal cycling chambers. This way, the missing elements of the specification of components can be discovered. Finally, a very popular measure is to select components with flight heritage. Although limited flight heritage does not provide significant statistical output, which can be used to assess reliability quantitatively, many potential design and testing flaws, which could lead to infant mortality, as well as susceptibility to total ionization dose, becomes less concern. For large, expensive spacecraft, the longing for flight heritage keeps them sometimes very conservative and prevents innovation. Even for CubeSat nowadays, flight heritage becomes a major trade-off criterion. Conformal coating is a thin polymeric film which is applied over a fully assembled electronic board. It protects the board against the environment such as moisture and provides extra structural rigidity to the circuit. It also improves the thermal handling capability. The improvement in reliability may be subtle, but since it's not so difficult and expensive to do, it may still be worthwhile. The most important measure to improve reliability, however, is testing. I know, I'm kicking in an open door here. However, you may still be surprised how often in space projects the testing phase is too limited. Testing is the last thing you do before delivery to the integrator or the launch provider, so it becomes the number one victim when budget or time runs out. It is not only important to do extensive and complete testing, You even have to take testing into account when designing a spacecraft. When designing, for instance, software or electrical circuits, you have to consider how you can test each part individually as well as integrated. Take also into account that the redundancy and FDIR could become a hazard itself if not properly tested. While these failure mechanisms might also be the most comprehensive to test. So if there is something to remember for this session in a few years from now, it is testing, testing, and testing. Well, this ends the part on command and data handling. I hope you have enjoyed it.